All right, welcome Strange Music fans. This is Ponch, and we have an exclusive interview with Strange Music CEO, Travis O'Gwynn. How's it going, Travis?
It's going, man.
All right, lots of stuff going on here at the label. Let's get to the very first one. Tech N9ne's The Storm hits stores next Friday, December 9th. Tell us what your thoughts are, because Tech has described this as one of his best pieces of work. What are some of your favorite tracks off of it? And overall thoughts of the project?
I really think that every one of his projects, I mean, every time we release an album on Tech, I think that it's better than his last work. And that's really what we strive for. That's what we have to accomplish each and every time. And that not just for Tech, but for every single artist. I think the additional significance of this one is when you started out in this business calling your first album The Calm Before the Storm, and here you are exactly 20 years later, and you actually title the album The Storm, it better be good. I mean, it has to be. So when you think about that, it's like, I know he put a lot into it. It took an excessive amount of time to do this album. This album took him longer than any other album that we've ever recorded. So if you just look at that and say, oh, wow, okay, wait a minute. And there's a lot, I mean, there's some features on there and there's some pretty incredible features, but this album isn't as much about the features as it is about what he wanted to do lyrically.
What really blew me away is the amount of material, because in this day and age, it seems like artists will just, you know, they'll throw out 12 tracks, 13 tracks, 16 tracks just to, you know, appease their fans. But there is a lot of material on The Storm. How many tracks total?
You know what? I'm sitting here looking at the deluxe track listing has 20 numbers, and I want to say that there's only one skit out of those 20 numbers. So that's pretty significant. I mean, not very many people put 19 full tracks on an album. And then in addition to that, there's a bonus disc in with that deluxe album as well, which also has additional Tech N9ne songs, but also other songs from other artists on the label. We thought it would be a cool idea to introduce some of the other artists' music. So we have JL's on there, Darian is on there, McKenzie is on there, Cess Crew, Recognize, MERS, and then the rest, of course, is all Tech N9ne. And there's another 12 tracks on the bonus album. So, you know, when it comes to giving the fans an excessive amount of music, Tech continues to do that. You know what I'm saying? Everything that he records, he puts so much into each one of the songs that he feels like, God, I need to make sure someone hears this. And so then, of course, when we tell him, hey, listen, from a mechanical standpoint, from a publishing standpoint, do 14, 15 songs. Right. And then he always ends up coming and filling up the entire disc. And it's a matter of signing off, because we're manufacturing discs that some CD players can't even play. You know what I mean? The older CD players. So he always packs it in there. And you know what? I'm not gonna harp on him to shorten the process. If he has that much to say, then it's important that we get it out to the fans.
Absolutely. I mean? Yeah. And you talk about some of those new artists that are going to be on that bonus disc. And there's a lot of talk around Strange Music about the new artists that you're signing. Mm-hmm. And you made a very big announcement the other day about Above Waves.
Yeah. You know what, man? I did that. And I think I might have pissed some people off here at the label. And I care. And then in the same, I don't give a fuck.
A lot of people are asking, yeah, are you abandoning hip hop? I mean, yeah, straight out. Are you going mainstream?
No, I mean, here's what I'm doing. I'm trying to put out the absolute best music, period. And whether that be in our traditional sense, hip hop, whether that be in what we've done in R&B, what we've done in rock music, and now what we're doing with popular music, there's no abandonment of shit. There's no abandonment of anything. It's just us continuing to grow our brand and to branch into other things that we truly enjoy. You know, and I'll get more into that here in a little bit. But, you know, like with the Above Waves announcement, I'm sitting here and I'm listening to what has rapidly become one of my most favorite albums that we've ever done. And it happens to be four dudes, three of them are from Chicago, one's from here in Kansas City, that are doing more of like a rock music that leans definitely more pop. And I absolutely love it. Here's the thing, man. I love incredible music. And a lot of people know that about me, because if you listen to what I put out over the years on Strange Music and what I've associated myself with and what I've been a part of, all I care about is top-notch, great music. And so when I listen to Above Waves every time I'm at the gym, and not that it's that type of music, it just, I enjoy it that much. Or when I'm at home listening to it, and that's the music that I find myself tuning into when I'm sitting in my home office, and that's the music where I just want a little bit of an escape, and I'm listening to these songs that they're putting out, like Simple Things and like Closer, I say putting out, that they put together, and I'm so impressed by the sonic quality of it, by the writing, by the music itself, what Seven has done with them, and what a lot of these other producers have done. The gentleman from Nashville, whose name escapes me this very second, but he's been an integral part of their career, you know, sending them out to Los Angeles to work with people. I'm just excited about the project. So the other day, what I was talking about as far as pissing people off, I think I was pissing off the executives here, like, oh, wait a minute, dude, did he just really announce that Above Waves has been signed for nearly 3 years? Yes, I did, because I'm sitting here listening to this shit. I was so enthusiastic that day about the possibilities and the future of the label and the music that these guys produce, that I'm like, man, I know we're in a holding pattern and we're trying to get everything perfect, but fuck that. Like, I want people to know about these guys. I want people to start taking notes. I want people to start tuning in. So whenever we do release music from these guys, I want to make sure that people are listening, because it's that good. And listen, it may not be for everybody. I'm not even, and this isn't a force feed, right? This isn't saying, hey, listen, if you love strange music, you have to love Above Waves. I'm not naive. I'm not out of my mind. This may not be for you, and that's completely okay. It might be for you, though. You know what I mean? If you actually listen to it and let your girlfriend listen to it and make sure that you're paying attention to how good it really is, then I think you'll give it a chance. And again, if you don't do anything but hip-hop, this might not be for you, and that's cool. If you don't do anything but rock music and then you dabble in Tech N9ne, this might not be for you. But then again, maybe it will be. But what I do believe is that it'll be for a massive, massive amount of people. I think that's why they call it pop music, right? Popular. You just shorten it to pop. And I know there's such a negative feeling about, oh my God, I can't believe they're going to do pop music. Man, fuck all your titles. I'm doing music. I'm putting out music that we enjoy. Tech loves this new project. I love this new project. Seven loves this new project. Dave, I believe you're very fond of it. I mean, you come from that world.
Absolutely.
But this is about great music more than any fucking title or label that people want to put on it. You know.
Let me get back to the pop land, because I do want to talk to you and you know, encourage the fans, the bass fans of Strange Music, that you said you are not abandoning hip hop, because you know there's a lot of shit online that they're like going, oh, you guys are going mainstream. You said mainstream was going to come to you, this, that, and the other. You know, for the core fans that came up with Strange Music, what are some of the projects that we have in 2017 they can be really excited about? I know one of them in particular is Stevie Stone.
Yeah, man, Stevie Stone. You know what? I'm going to go ahead and do something that I said I wasn't going to do, but I might as well, right? It's going to be fun.
Give us all a raise.
Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, well, you're cutting out, man. It's weird. We're in the same room and you're cutting out.
I'm new.
So
I'm
crazy.
The only one laughing.
Ah, yeah. Everybody else is like, oh, shit.
Jesus, no. Lighten up, guys.
No. So listen, I'm going to go ahead and I'm just going to ramble through what is on this next year. Okay, so first of all, 2017 is going to be the biggest year that we've ever had. And there's another year that I made a decision, a conscious decision, to put out 11 projects, right? And everybody at the label almost died. It was entirely too much work for the staff that we had. And a lot of people were stressed out and stretched out and everything else. But we got it done. And it was a great year. And it was a lot of music. And a lot of people really loved that particular year. So this year, already, and you know what, I hope that all of these happen, but there's already 13 albums on the schedule for next year.
Wow.
More than one a month, you know, obviously. So when I read this schedule out loud, a lot of people are going to be like, oh my God, you're either going to get excited, or if you're in this room, you might end up getting anxiety. You know, if the rest of the staff is watching, I mean, they're kind of aware of next year's schedule, but this might let it completely out of the bag. The very first album of the year, which we're wrapping up as we speak, is Sescrew. We also have a MERS album, which is 90%+ done. We also have a Tech N9ne Collabos album, which I may elaborate on a little bit later on about how this one is assembled so much differently than all the past Collabos records. Stevie Stone album, we have that on the schedule. Recognize from Mayday. I'm so looking forward to, I'm a huge Recognize fan as well. Then I have a Tech N9ne Presents JL, which a lot of you know that he's the newest signing as far as the rap division of our label, and very excited. Man, this kid's recording a ton of songs. He's got some that I quite enjoy. As a matter of fact, I put one of them on the bonus disc for Tech's album. We also have Darian Saffron. Which a lot of people, you know, like I've been looking at, every once in a while I tune into what people think of the music, and they're eating this kid's lunch, right?
It's a little different from what Strange has done.
Totally fine, but it's in the R&B vein, which is some of the stuff that I've done with Chris Calico and others, but a lot of people like to be critics, right? Mm-hmm. They love to be internet fucking critics, and they're in their, you know, parents' basement and shit stained underwears, and they want to throw out a lot of hatred.
Well, here's a little thing that, you know, caught my interest about Darian too, is the backstory of Darian, which I don't think a lot of people know. Yeah. And just quickly, if you could just give kind of a backstory about how he came up and how you found him and here he is today. Because he's only, what, like 20?
Yeah. And here's the thing, man. Darian is one of the most talented guys on the label. People just haven't got to experience it yet. He is unbelievably talented. I'm very, very excited about this kid. I have clips of him at 4 years old performing on local news stations in St. Louis, right? I have other clips of him in bars at 5 and 6 years old entertaining bars full of people. I have him, I think he was 9 or 10 years old, I can't remember the exact age, where Whoopi Goldberg is announcing him at the Apollo. You know what I mean? And so this kid has been in music his entire life. His parents were into music, his father especially. You know, I don't know the whole backstory on his father. I get a little Joe Jackson vibe from him, like, you know, okay, what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, he inbred music into this kid, and this kid is like unbelievable, man. His voice, his ability to write, and what he does in the studio, and his work ethic is incredible. And I started dabbling around, you know, Stevie Stone brought me a record that had this kid on it. And I took note, and I absolutely love the record. And I'm like, wow, okay, I got to know more about this kid. And I found out he was in the middle of a deal at the time, and he was only 17 back then. And you know, I had no interest in dealing with kids that aren't of age, you know, because sometimes it gets complicated with the parents and all this other stuff. But we took the time to listen, and then eventually he kind of navigated out of that other bad deal that he had, and we had an opportunity, and we embraced that, and he's been signed for quite some time. A lot of people don't know that, and we've just been working on his music, working on helping him develop it, getting him with the right producers. I've sent this kid to LA, God, at least 7-8 times to spend weeks at a time working with all these high-level producers like The Jam and like Scott Storch and all of these guys. So the things in which Darian is doing and the music that we have, and we have tons and tons of songs. As a matter of fact, we had enough songs to where I think we took like 16 or 17 of them, and we're letting him put out a mixtape with a bunch of the stuff that we're not actually going to use on the album.
When is that coming out?
December 16th is what I think. So December 16th, that mixtape's going to come out. But and it's just a representation of a touch of what this kid is about. And we left it intentionally rough. We didn't like super mix it. We didn't even master it. We just kind of pseudo mastered it because we want people to hear the rawness and the talent that this kid really possesses. But when we get to the album, he's got some songs on there that are mind-blowingly good. You know, the song Tatiana, which I'm extremely excited about. So Darian is somebody that I think the masses will like. I think it's going to be more R&B, urban R&B. Which is hilarious because he's a white kid. But, you know, if I say this horrible analogy where I say if Chris Brown and Michael Jackson had a baby and it came out white, it would be this
kid.
It'd
be real fucked up.
Yeah, it'd be out of here. But that's what Darian is. He has that level, that caliber of talent. So, but Darian's on the schedule. We also have a Mayday album coming out this next year. We also have Above Waves, who I've already mentioned a little bit earlier, which is an album that I'm extremely excited about as well. I don't think there's anything that I'm not excited about, but for us to be able to share this new division of our label with everybody this coming year is a pretty exciting thing.
Yeah, let's get to the biggest one. You know, she's been called the Princess of Strange Music, your daughter, Mackenzie Nicole.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
You know, you've been working with her here for the past year on a solo level, but she's been singing on Strange Track since 9. Is that right?
Yeah, she recorded her first track with Tech and 3-6 Mafia when she was 9 years old. You know, and a lot of people need to understand this. The very last thing in the world her mother and I wanted, and I think I said this in a Instagram or tweet or something a week or two ago, is for her to be in the music business. Really had no interest in her getting into this game. And that's not shitting on the entire music business, but when you're in this business, you realize about 90% of it is complete shit. I mean, it's shitty people, it's shitty situations. It's not something that I wanted her to be exposed to. You know what I mean? She grew up around it. She's been to over 1,000 shows because she used to go on tour with me, you know? And so getting her into the business wasn't our intention. Now, going back to when she was like 2 years old and in the backseat of our car, hearing her like sing along with songs, and then every once in a while seeing when the radio wasn't on. And I think at age 3, there was this one moment where it sounded like a grown woman was singing in the back seat with a bit of vibrato. And it's almost impossible. Your throat isn't developed enough at 3 to do this. And she did it. And we're like, did you hear that? And I mean, I remember to this day, man, she's 3 years old in the back seat. And she was singing songs that were just like, what in the hell? And so we eventually took her to this opera singer who classically trains, you know, people for opera and other things. And she wouldn't even entertain it because Mackenzie was too young. She was only 4 at that time. And we said, well, could you at least just listen to her? And she took the time to go ahead and listen to her and indeed, like, took her on immediately. Like, oh, my. And brought her into the mix. And then we've really been working with her on a weekly basis since she was 6, okay? So she started really getting in there and classically trained in opera, singing in multiple languages, singing in Italian, singing in French. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that she's doing. And then her love for singing, I think, made Tech take notice. And then he wanted to say, hey, man, I got this song, and I think that she might be able to do this part. And she came into the studio. I even have the footage and knocked it out. And he was like, what? And since then, I think we're 7 or 8 different songs over the course of time, you know, with songs like Fear and other songs that are very meaningful songs too.
But now that she's going, you know, solo and she's doing her own thing, I mean, I think it's important to address the haters out there. And we'll get into her new single right now, Deleted, kind of addresses some of those internet trolls that are out there that kind of just, you know, secretly in somebody's mom's basement are just spewing a lot of hate. But there are some comments that are thrown out there that, you know, you fast-tracked her because she is your daughter.
Right,
they've said that, you know, you've given her a pass.
Yeah.
You know, I'd like to hear your response.
Nepotism is the furthest thing in the world from what's really happening. I mean, when we ended up doing, you know, the Acting Like You Know song was actually something where Tech was supposed to give her a song to feature on for the Collabos project, you know, and he didn't get it done. He was too busy. He was chaotic. He needed to leave for tour. So I said, okay, you know what? That's okay. And she was a little bit bummed out because she loves singing and she loves doing this, right? So I was like, don't worry about it. I said, you know what, babe, hold on. And I got a hold of 7. I said, hey, 7, I want you and Mackenzie to work together. And let's go ahead and have her do a song. And then we'll send it out to Tech on the road and just have him do a feature on it. And then we'll put that on the album. As a matter of fact, her song and one of Darian's songs were the only songs like that on that last Collabos record, right? That last Collabos album, where they had their own individual songs that just featured Tech. So it was a little bit different. And so we didn't do anything extra at all for Acting Like You Know. And when that album came out and all those songs were released, the most popular song on the entire album was Acting Like You Know.
Wow.
So wait a minute, how you got a little 16-year-old blonde-haired, blue-eyed girl on a predominantly hip-hop album, and this is the most popular song? So I'm like, shit, that just happened? Okay. So then I had to embrace it to a certain degree, and I said, you know what, that's deserving of us creating a visual for it, so let's go ahead and shoot a video. I talked to the guys, we ended up putting together the ideas, we shot the video, then we ended up releasing the video, and it went to 1 million plays in like a week, faster than any other artist outside of Tech has ever went. And so I'm like, shit, here we go. You know, like, this is actually a real thing that I can't prevent. I mean, it's definitely happening. So then you go from thinking, okay, well, you don't really want this for her, but at the same time, it's happening. I would be a complete asshole at this point not to embrace it and not to make it something for her, you know, and because she loves it and because she's good at it and because people love her, I would be a complete asshole not to support it. But the idea of nepotism, no way.
Do you feel like you're easier or harder on her because you're the
super
dad?
Super hard on her.
Harder than other artists?
Yeah, matter of fact, I feel bad about it sometimes, man. I mean, I make her rehearse harder because if you're going to do this, you're gonna do it right. I make her really work on her vocals. I continue to make her go to her classes and do vocal training. I continue. So not on no Joe Jackson shit, but listen, if this is really something you want to do, you're going to have to prove yourself. You're not going to get it handed to you. I'm not going to do you any fucking favors. And she knows that. I make it abundantly clear to her that this is not going to be a handout. You have to work for it. You have to write. You have to record. You have to be efficient. You have to be able to perform at a high level. And man, she's shutting me down every time. Like she
proud dad though.
I super proud, man. I mean, I'm more proud of her as a person, because she's what a lot of people don't know about McKinsey is she's like exceptionally intelligent. Don't know where the hell that came from, but she's like out of here smart. You know, 7 of the 8 Ivy League schools right now are pursuing her for college. And that's rare that Ivy Leagues do that. And so she's that smart, you know, perfect grades, straight A, 4.0 throughout high school, all college AP classes, certificates for days. This girl's I don't even know if she's from here, man. She's like, she scares the shit out of me sometimes. Like, I'm like, why is she, dude, like she intimidates a lot of us here at the, you know, the staff. Like, they're like, oh shit, an email from McKinsey. Okay, hold on, man. I really got to think about this response because she's so articulate and so well, she's better with the English language than anybody that works at this label, including me. I promise you that, man. She's exceptional. I shouldn't be judging her against you because you talk a lot, but I'm just saying,
that's fine.
She's out of here, man. She's a pretty special person.
Let's get back to Tech N9ne the Storm in stores December 9th. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the questions I wanted to ask you, because I'm a huge fan of hip hop, have been since I was a little kid. You know, one of the first pieces of music I got was N.W.A. You know, that was how I started into hip hop, mm-hmm, way back in the day. I wanted to get your thoughts on the state of hip hop today and where it's going, because what tech does is not necessarily what is going on right now. He's always had his own style. So I just wanted to get your thoughts as a CEO of a hip hop label. You know, what do you think of hip hop music right now?
You know what? I think there's a lot of great music out there, man. I think there's a lot of great hip hop out there. I don't necessarily get it all, and maybe it's not for me to get, but it's obvious that a lot of other people do get it. So some of these youngsters listen to some music that sonically isn't very pleasing to me, but I refuse to be the guy that hates on it. It's just, I guess, not for me. So I may not particularly understand all the different levels of hip hop right now. To me, lyrics are important. Lyrics are always important. The storytelling of hip hop is what I grew up on. The message in hip hop is what I grew up on. So when I go all the way back and I'm listening to stuff like LL Cool J and then the early stuff and the MC Shan and Kool Moe Dee, and then, you know, when the West Coast stuff hit with Eazy-E and N.W.A. and Ice-T, that was the kind of music that I really enjoy. And then as that continued, that storytelling continued to develop, and then you have the Biggies and the Tupacs of the world. That's the stuff I remember the most because that's when I probably consumed the most music, right? So that's my era of hip hop. So I still like music with a message. Sometimes the music nowadays doesn't have the same type of message. Doesn't necessarily mean it's bad music. It just means that it's not my particular flavor of hip hop right now. And some of it, man, like some of this shit is completely retarded. And then I find myself singing along with it. You know what I mean? So and there's some new
Broccoli's
stuff out.
Your ringtone, right?
Maybe not.
Okay.
But you know, 200 million streams. They've done an incredible job with that song. Like, I'm amazed by it. Man, I'm intrigued, amazed. I want to know how. I want to understand it. And
well, let's talk about that. Let's talk about streaming, because that's one of the things in the music business. You and I have been in the music business one way or another for very long time, decades.
Right.
You know, and streaming has become the norm rather than physical. People still go buy physical. In fact, I was in a store the other day where they had two aisles of turntables, mm-hmm. which I was like, wow, that's pretty amazing.
Kind of cool.
So how has that changed your business model and how you're doing things right now with streaming music like Pandora, Spotify, Apple Music, Beats, Tidal?
It's constantly evolving, right? And so when I got into the music business, I got in at the absolute wrong time. I got into it when it was taking a complete shit. So we started the label in 2000. And, you know, we started putting together the ideas in 99, started it in 2000. And, of course, you know, that was like the beginning of the end for the music business, quite frankly. It was really starting to spiral out of control downward. And so when I got into it, I didn't believe all of the shit that was going on. Napster's the death of the business. Not necessarily. I'm not going to buy into that because I don't believe that that's the case. I believe that good music still sells. So whenever I got into it, I did things in the early days like fuck the industry, the whole FTI campaign. And I said, hey, if you if you love great music, come to our website, download the new album, Absolute Power, for free, and if you like it, please support us by going out and buying it. And I had buyers mad at me, telling me to fuck off, and we're not going to buy any of your product anymore. You're out of your mind. We had 400% increases, and so I was right. Good music still sold. And so then, you know, you have that to where I wasn't buying in, but then here comes streaming, you know, later on. And the whole streaming concept is a very interesting one. I've been vocally against it, like in a very aggressive way, because monetarily it's created a devastating environment for us, right? We had
for a lot of artists,
well,
not just strange music, but for a lot of artists,
over a 5-year period, we had a 78% decrease in our revenue on music, and that's pretty unbelievable. So when you look at the impact that it had on us financially, I couldn't embrace it on the onset because it was such a poor financial model. The people that came up with this really didn't do much forward thinking. And the people that got involved from the major label and the equity side, that didn't include us, the independents. So I couldn't get on board at all with it originally. And I had to wait, I had to hold out for years and years and years, because for me, it had to reach some point of critical mass to where it was going to be able to be financially rewarding so that I could do what? So that I can make more music. If that's what the fans want, it takes a lot of money for us to put these artists in studios, to get this production, to get it done properly, and to get it ready to present to you. I'm spending millions and millions of dollars doing that. So if I have to do that, I obviously need to generate that revenue in order to accomplish that goal. So that's the part where we have to be very careful. Thankfully, we have such a diverse business with merchandising, with touring and everything else. We're probably going to be one of the only that survive, because a lot of people are not surviving. A lot of labels have went out of business, especially since streaming has had the impact that it had on the revenue side. So now I think that we're at this critical mass where streaming is becoming, I said in an interview, and this is I think in 2002, I said the music business will resurrect itself once music convenience is created, right? So to me back then, and I had a horrible, horrible analogy of how, but I said, when you're sitting on your toilet and you can speak to the voice on the wall and hum the voice on the wall a song, they identify it. And this is before Shazam, by the way, and they can identify it. And then, yeah, I want that song. And then the transaction just happens. That was the type of music convenience that I was thinking about back then. What I realized is Spotify, Apple Music, these are the new music conveniences. This is the direction in which people are going to consume music in the future. I heard some kids recently say, hold on, what do you mean download songs? That like kids like so look, if that's the nature, this is what's happening. Spotify, Pandora, all these different streaming services, that's the future of the business.
And they're starting to figure it out. I mean, you can see the inconsistencies. I mean, Spotify right now is offering something like 3 months for like $1 to mm-hmm. get you hooked on it. Mm-hmm. You know, Apple Music, there's talks that price point per month is going to come down around the holidays. Mm-hmm. You know, Pandora. So I think once they get in a unified front,
yeah,
and charge one price for streaming music, then you're going to see that going. And I believe that's in the next year.
I think that a lot of things have to happen real soon, because you have a company like Spotify that's either going to do, probably to me, they're going to have to do one of two things. they're going to either sell, have some big evaluation, and they're going to sell to a big company, a very large company, whether it be a Facebook or somebody of that caliber, or they're going to go for an IPO. And when you go for an IPO, then all of a sudden you have a board of directors and you have a responsibility to become profitable, right? So if indeed they go for an IPO, that's going to change the game too, because still yet 70% of Spotify's listeners are listening for free. And when you can consume all the music you want for free, dude, that's not really fair to the people that create the music, because they're not getting any revenue. The revenue is minimal, minimal, minimal. So, you know, in order for the creatives to be able to do what they do, there's going to have to be money generated in order to support that process. Doesn't mean you need to make all these artists filthy rich, but at least do something to support them in a way that's going to allow them to continue to create. If indeed they go for that and they have a board of directors, you know, there's no more spending hundreds of millions of dollars in this developing thing, you know, and basing your evaluation off of your debt. That's a crazy concept, but that's the way it works. You're going to have to become profitable. So that 70% is going to shrink to about 10 or 20% very quickly. People are going to have to pay for the service. Or, you know, you can go back and you can use the drug analogy, get you hooked, and now you got to pay, right? Or the cable television. When cable television came out, it started out at $5 a month. Now, cable television, average bill, $132 a month. So, not saying that streaming needs to do that, but if those other 70% that weren't paying just paid a minimum of $9.99 a month, it would change the entire landscape of the music business significantly. And if you go back and some of these people that are in a situation like, oh my God, man, $9.99 a month or $19.99 a month, that's too much. I used to spend $150 a week at the record store. You know what I'm saying? So I'm trying to buy 7 to 10 CDs every week. Like the way we had to do it, they were $15, $16, $17. So the idea
that was just for one album.
For one album.
Now you have the entire universe.
You have all of the music for if that's not worth $20 a month, dude, I'm confused. To me, I would pay $50 a month for that, because I can consume all the music I want and get all this additional bonus features and stuff. I would spend some $50 a month. That's a cakewalk compared to what I was doing at $150 a week. So I mean, the music is important to me. So, you know, it may not be as important to the casual user. So let's find that happy medium, that sweet spot that says, okay, the people that aren't necessarily consuming as much music, a fair price for them, and a fair price that equates to the people that do love music, and get people excited about music again. You know what I mean? And get them out there and consuming. But streaming is the future. There's no way around it. And I'm not going to be some old, you know, archaic guy that's like, oh, resistant. I had to hit a certain point before I was convinced that it was the right move for us. And now we are beginning to embrace it. I was just in Los Angeles 2 weeks ago, meeting with all the top people from Spotify and talking to the curators and talking to the people that handle, you know, all of these different playlists and so forth. I've been talking to other label owners who are more advanced than me on the whole streaming world, and learning and educating myself with their knowledge. And I also just had tech at Spotify in New York yesterday going over all the things that are important to him and making sure he has an understanding, and meeting with some of the high ups there in New York. And now we are going to embrace it, and embrace it in a way that hopefully can help us grow that portion of the business to where it then makes financial sense. That's what this is about. We still believe in selling physical CDs, though. We love people that love the experience of having the artwork, possessing the physical copy, adding it to their collection, or buying the vinyl. That's what it's still about, man.
I think that's very cool. I mean, Tech's doing, a couple of in-stores next week around the drop of his album.
Yeah, man, we're doing an in-store on Thursday night at FYE over at 40 Highway Nolan Road in Independence. And so it's the night before the release, and we're going to be there. And then we have a show. Actually, Mackenzie Nicole has a show on Friday in which both Tech and Chris are going to be special guests, and that's at the Uptown Theater.
Tove Lo and Zara Larsson.
Tove Lo, Zara Larsson.
95.7 The Vibes, Elfmas. That's going to be a great show.
Yeah, and it's doing very well. And then the very next day, we're going to be in Denver, Colorado, doing a huge in-store out there for them, you know, and everybody's like, dude, what are you doing to the schedule? Because on Sunday is our big Christmas event. I mean, you're gonna do this on Thursday, this on Friday, then send them to Denver to, yeah, man, we owe Denver that, man. Denver is such a supportive city for us. You're going to get an in-store. And yes, I do. I got to fly dude back the very next day and get him here in time for our big event, our big Christmas event. But we wouldn't have it any other way. We got to do that stuff. You know what I mean?
If we talk about expansion, and I know we're running out of time here, but I do want to talk about that. We put out a video not too long ago about expanding Strange Music. What is on the horizon? Let's just say in the next 2 years, what's in your? You're obviously a very successful businessman. You're a very smart guy. In 2 years, I know you probably have a 2, a 5, and a 10-year plan, but let's hear about 2 years for Strange Music.
Well, you know what I want to do, man? I think I stopped here on Above Waves. I also wanted to do this. Above Waves was the 9th album that I mentioned about coming out next year. I also don't want to shortchange the other artists, so I have Ritz also coming out next year, too. And then, people aren't going to believe this, but I have another Tech N9ne full album coming out toward the end of next year, which is crazy to be able to do another one. But he's got that much on his mind, and he wants to get this out. And so
he just did an interview the other day, Sway in the Morning. He had mentioned trying to get Jay-Z on the tech on the track.
Yeah.
What's the possibility?
I think it's great. I mean, come on, man. If we got everybody from The Doors to Eminem to Jonathan Davis, Corey Taylor, Boyz II Men. I mean, we Tech has probably got the highest level of features of any hip-hop artist on the planet. I mean, the dude has done songs with nearly everybody who's anybody. You understand what I'm saying? So at the end of the day, I think that the JC thing will eventually happen. I think the Nas, I think that whatever record he dreams up, as long as there's another beat that says, oh man, I hear so-and-so on this, as long as that hits him, then I think we're golden. If that doesn't hit him, then it may never happen. But I think that Tech is the level of artist and has the level of respect to get whatever feature he desires. I truly believe that. So there's going to be some cool things in the future. I know, but I also know this too, man, and this might be refreshing or not to some people, but Tech is also talking about doing more and more records without any features. I think that's a lot of where his head's at, because I think he has enough stuff to say that he's going to be doing more and more records that have absolutely no features at all. So it's something to think about. The 12th album that we have for next year, Mackenzie Nicole. And then also Chris Calico will have an album next year. That's 13. That's crazy. I don't even know if this is a smart thing to do. Now, obviously, there might be a little bit of flexibility, but my belief is that 10 of these are solid locked and 3 are just a little bit floating. So if we can accomplish putting out that much music next year, that's going to be crazy. That's going to be really good. And by the way, you say we're running out of time. Who's running out of time? What y'all got to do? I don't run out of time. Okay, good. Yeah,
good.
You got cars and shit, because this shit ain't going. We ain't in until 7 p.m.
Wow. You motherfucker. I didn't know that. I got a thing after this.
Sorry, buddy.
One of my last questions, though, is that, again, you are very successful, and for an up-and-coming entrepreneur, aspiring entrepreneur out there, or even an aspiring artist, hip-hop or pop or whatever, I mean, what is your best advice? Because this is a very tough business to get into. What's your best advice for somebody out there watching, listening to this, and thinking this might be for me?
You know, it is an extremely difficult business to win in. So as long as you understand that the odds are definitely against you, I think that that's the first realization that you have to have. And, you know, that's going to mean if you walk into this business, if you get into this business knowing that it's extraordinarily difficult, right, but yet you still continue to pursue it, that means that it means that much to you. It means that you have a real passion to try to get into this. Because if I'm sitting here telling you this is the most difficult thing to succeed in and you still pursue it, that means that it's more than just a desire to be famous. It's something that you truly love and you want to do. If you continue this path, what you need to do is you have to look at what is before you now. Like, how are other people succeeding? That's what I do, man. I looked at, I case studied the hell out of a lot of people you wouldn't even think of, man. I mean, one of my, Kid Rock, Hank Williams Jr., what? Ray Charles, even Psychopathic Records, Suburban Noise Records, looking at what Rhymesayers has done. Looking at Fool's Gold. I mean, there's so many different people that I've studied. And then what I did is I took the parts of them. I mean, Big Machine, Taylor Swift's label. I mean, I take the things that I think they did right, and I try to adopt some of their ideas. And I look at the, I also learn a lot by the people that do a lot of shit wrong. Like, the good thing is not everything you're going to learn in the music business is correct and or right by any means. What you have to do is you have to ingest it, and you have to figure out what will truly work and what you think will work best. You know, and a lot of that's just evaluation of history. What has gotten other people to this point? And then having a really good a common sense variable. Like I don't think anything that I've done or that I've accomplished from the music business has been some you know, high level of intelligence, rocket science type shit. What I believe, though, is I have a very good gut instinct. I think that your instinct is very important. I think that understanding what is going on around you is very important. I think that continuing to keep an open mind every single day. Today, I learned some shit today, actually, and I try to learn something every day. So every day that I get up, I seek information. I seek knowledge from people that are further up in the game than me. And I try to understand what worked for them, what didn't work for them, and what can I learn from their experiences in addition to what all of my own experiences are. And if I keep a student's mentality every single day, I'm going to find a way to succeed. I'm going to find a way to educate myself. I'm going to find a way to do better. And if I can do better every single day, and that's in all aspects of life, man. This just doesn't apply to business. This applies to your personal life. This applies to every single thing you do. People think that I have disorders, and I probably do. I probably have many disorders.
You're a little fucked up.
Yeah, that's cool. I'm super fucked up, actually. Obsessive compulsive, all that kind of shit. I'm not like turning the fucking light switch on and off 12 times, but I am doing some really excessive shit. And my ability to be organized is at the very, very forefront of everything that I do. I love organization. I love things.
You say that's your number one habit?
Absolutely.
Organization. Yeah.
Organization is the number one habit. Absolutely. Because it creates efficiencies for everything else that I do. If I'm incredibly organized, and I mean down to every single detail of my life, it creates an amazing amount of efficiency for me. Because I know exactly where everything's at. I know where to go to get it. And I know what everything is in a place. You know what I mean? And so with that organization, then that allows me to then, and I share that, and I insist that others become organized that are around me. And you know, if you do, great. And if you don't, maybe not so great, you know, like, good luck. But I want to put really thoughtful, organized people around me that care about things the way that I do, and that are passionate the way that I am. And again, it doesn't just apply to the business, but it applies to my personal life. Like, I have three children. I have a 26-year-old daughter. I have a 17-year-old daughter and a 4-year-old son. It's very important that every day I think about them and to be like the best father that I can to them. You know what I mean? And to set the best examples and to make sure that I'm teaching them the right path, the right way, the way to be. You know what I mean? And if I can continue to do that and continue to do that with people around me, I had an hour and a half long meeting. I went to drop off a couple of gold plaques yesterday to a friend of mine that well deserves them. And my intention was to be there for 5 minutes. And about an hour and a half later into our conversations, you know, he gave me some really great pointers and some things that he learned, you know, from a friend of his. And it's taking that knowledge and sharing that amongst people, you know. And he said something too yesterday, like, you know, grown men have a tendency to hold everything in, right? They hold everything in. They don't really share their experiences or their thoughts or their ideas with other grown-ass men. And that's a shame, because what he and I did yesterday alone enlightened me on a few things. You know what I'm saying? It really helped me take a different approach to things. And so that's, I'm constantly trying to improve myself for on behalf of my kids, my wife, my business, and the way in which I conduct and navigate, because we got one go around. You understand what I'm saying? We're only here once. I'm 45 years old. I got a certain amount of time left to do this thing, this music business. And in that time, I want to make it the absolute best that I can make it. And I'm only going to be able to do that with constant self-evaluation.
Do you put a time limit on your time here?
You know what?
Not on Earth, but I'm not trying to get heavy. I'm talking about Strange Music, you know? I mean, how long are you going to run this label?
I recently dedicated another 10 years to it, okay? I talked to my wife, who would probably prefer that I retire. Same probably with my kids. But, you know, and at one point I told my wife, listen, when I get to 40, I'm done, you know, and I don't need to work. It ain't the music business. I have other businesses, many other businesses. We have 11 different companies and I've done well. I've been fortunate. You know, I would say that I'm lucky, but man, I work my ass off. So I don't know if luck applied to it or not, man. But at the end of the day, financially, I've been cool for a long time. I've been cool financially before I got into the music business. Fuck, I dumped $2 million into the business before I ever got a dime back. So, you know, I told her one time that I was going to stop working when I was 40. And, you know, my wife and I met when we were 14 years old. So she's hung in there for a while, dude. Mm-hmm. And with my lifestyle and the shit that I've had to do and leave for 10 months at a time, hats off to her, man. What the fuck was she thinking? You know what I mean? But I told her I would stop at 40. Then I told her I would stop at 45. That's how old I am now. And then I just recently spoke to her and I said, listen, I just want to do it 10 more years. And I don't think that's what she wanted to hear, but I think she cares enough for me to let me. She knows that I can't not do anything. You understand what I'm saying? So
right, you'll drive her crazy.
Yeah, I'll drive. I'll end up going. But I got 5 years at the same pace in which I'm doing now, which is those 10, 12, 14-hour days. I can do that for another 5 years. After that, dude, my son's going to be playing a lot of baseball, I'm sure, because he's super tall and you know, I know he's going to be athletic. So I want to spend some time doing that. So at a reduced pace for that other 5 years. And then let me look at where we're at in 10 years. You know, will we sell this place? I don't, probably not. A lot of people have been trying to buy it for a long time.
You gonna sign more artists?
Yeah, I believe so. I'm not gonna sign them anytime soon. I wanna focus on the artists that we currently have. I am not interested in signing any artists right now, just because, honestly, I'd be doing them a disservice. I have to be on this kind of self-imposed signing freeze because we have more talent than time. That's the truth of the matter right now. And even though we have a staff in these buildings over here, like 42 people, it's not enough to do all the stuff that I'm talking about right here. You know what I'm saying? So at the end of the, man, you drop one more motherfucking thing, we're about to have a problem. Sorry, man. He's been making noise the whole interview. I just want to fucking throw something.
Go ahead.
No, I'm not going to do it, man.
On camera.
Not on camera. Afterwards, it's on. But listen. I really don't want to do any artists a disservice by signing them because I don't have that kind of time and I would be putting their careers on hold. And that's not, and not only that, but I'd be doing a disservice to the artists that are already on the label, man. I owe every one of the artists that we have signed a lot, man. If I believed in them enough to sign them, I got to do everything I can on their behalf. We're probably the most artist-centric label that exists, man. We actually give a whole lot of shit about them as individuals, about their personal lives, about their ability to earn incomes, about their ability to pay for their families and their kids. And so we owe them a lot, man. A lot of
people don't know that an artist, like on a major label, will get signed and then get courted there for a time and then thrown away.
Yeah.
Quickly.
Almost 80% of them.
Quickly. I'd say higher.
Thrown away. Yeah, it was only 18% of all music. This is a couple of years ago the statistic came out. Only 18% of the labels, of the artists signed to major labels were actually getting product on the shelf. And that's so sad, dude. Like, if you think, you know, you succeeded, you won, you got signed, you never have an album coming out. And you're stuck in a situation. Not cool. You know, so many of these major labels are doing this market share shit. They didn't want to miss anything just in case, oh, man, that might be hot. Sign them. Oh, man, there's a hot artist out of the South. The South's on fire. Go sign everybody you can from Atlanta. Okay, well, you're not doing anything but the business side of it and trying to get up all this market share. And then you basically just are destroying people's livelihoods by getting them locked up in situations they can't get out of. And so, you know, I don't have any interest in doing that with any of the artists on our label. I want to see each one of them succeed to the highest level And we're still building, man. I mean, we're still building. With Stevie Stone, we're building. With Chris Calico, man, his new direction is so impressive to me that I want to do nothing but help him become a household name. And I believe in him that much. I believe in him also on the artist development side of things. And, you know, he started working with McKinsey on a couple of things, and he's working with some of these other younger artists. I think he has a whole nother second career in that whole world. You know what I mean? But I do want to mention one thing, and I'm going to go backwards for just one second because I need people to understand this too. Seven and I first started discussing the desire to enter into popular music 7 years ago. So I want people to understand that when you start hearing this idea of us doing popular music, this isn't a new idea. This is something we've been talking about for years and years and years. We started looking, we were identifying some of these internet kids, we were going and looking at these conferences that these kids were doing, and we were looking for the people that could possibly be that popular music lane for us, right? And it took us a couple of years of searching. We had one kid that we thought was really dope, and then he ended up having serious, serious medical issues, and like so serious that he couldn't leave, you know, that kind of thing. And, you know, so this isn't a new thing for us. 5 years ago is when we started really plugging in pieces of it. And 3 years ago is when we did, nearly 3 years ago now, is when we did our first signings in the popular music thing. And so that's with Above Waves. One of the other acts just kind of happened, as I explained earlier, with Mackenzie Nicole. And then, of course, Darian, who we think is R&B, urban, but also will cross over into the pop world. These aren't new ideas. These are ideas that Seven, Tech, myself, Dave, we've had an interest in building this division of the business, and we're going to do it. And I think we're going to be quite successful in doing so. And for all the people, the internet little troll fucks, which I don't even read that shit anymore. I'm taking my daughter's advice. I'm just deleting the shit, right? Yeah. So, but for all of those people, man. I want to tell you, Strange Music will continue to be Strange Music. Strange Music will continue to be Tech N9ne, Chris Calico, Sess Crew, Stevie Stone, Mayday, MERS, Prozac. I mean, all of these acts are still like super important to us, and we're not ever going to abandon that. As a matter of fact, we're going to try to expand on it. We're trying to get bigger and better at that. And I've done a lot of efforts recently to expand every one of those people with meetings with different agencies, meetings with, again, the Spotify folks, meetings with brand alignments and everything else to try to continue to grow that.
Think we can ever get another MERS Day album?
I hope so, man.
That was one of my favorites.
It's so good. It's so good.
It's really good.
I know they want to do it. I know we want to do it. And the only thing in the way of it right now is time.
Just put it on the list. 14.
Sorry, it's already on here.
Thursday?
Yeah, Thursday right here. So, you know, we also have Prozac here. We also have Burns on here. We have Big Scoob on here. And then we have this idea for this another MERS project, 316. It's a very specific thing. And then another collabos in May of 2018. I'm pretty far out on my scheduling, man. I mean, I have to be because we have so much talent. Again, more talent than time. So if we don't plan things this far in advance, they won't come to fruition. But again, man, I mean, from this little interview, and I haven't done a lot of these lately, and I'm going to try to do more for people because I know they want to hear what's like happening and what's going on. But on the popular music front, man, check it out. You know what? And if it's not for you, no problem. I wish it. I'm not forcing anybody to listen to this. I couldn't do that. I would be a fool to be, thinking that I had some kind of power over people to make them listen to the kind of music that I put out. I'm going to put out what we believe to be incredible music, sonically, the well-written, very well-produced, well-mixed, well-mastered, great music. And if you like it, cool. I think you're going to. If you don't, no problem.
A lot of people are asking, what is Above Waves? I mean, what is the sound of Above Waves, really? Dude, I mean, we've described Mackenzie, and we've heard Mackenzie on the radio, and Darian, we've heard, and we've heard Ryan, do some feature stuff on Tech's stuff. But I mean, the band Above Waves, what does that sound like?
To me, they're the best of One Republic meets 1975 meets Maroon 5 meets, I mean, dude, it's, they're just, they're their own thing, right? And they're a fusion of so many things that are in that world, but man, they are definitely their own thing. And Ryan is an incredible frontman. He's incredible vocalist, an incredible writer. Lance, their drummer, incredible writer. I mean, you know, it's one of these things where it's these four guys who really love music, and this is the exact music they want to do. That's the important thing too to realize, is that each of these new artists are doing them. They're not doing something manufactured, bro. Like I never try to go and put like a somebody said, oh wow, they have a boy band. Fuck out of here. We're not assembling. We didn't do a rehearsal and put together a dub band or no stupid shit like that. I don't do that. I'm not going to try to put together a fucking boy band.
That's, yeah, there were three guys that were already together, and Ryan and Lance met, and they were in different bands, and
they came together.
It came naturally.
It came to me as Above Waves, as these four guys. It wasn't something we manufactured. All we did is said, okay, what are you guys trying to do? Oh, okay, that's dope. We're down. Let us help you. And then we hooked them up. We used our relationships and our power within the business to get to them, you know, the best people, all the people they wanted access to. We went and pursued them and got most of them. And, you know, hey, we really want this guy to mix the album. I'm like, oh, shit, okay. We reached out. We got to him. He mixed the album. All we did was help facilitate all the things that they desired. So you're not hearing something that's manufactured. You're hearing something that is these four guys, and it's the music they wanted to do. And we don't influence like that, man. We sign artists because they're dope artists, and we let them do them. And then we evaluate those results and see if we are there and if we have a product in which we think we can present. In this case, we're there. We can present this all day with the utmost confidence. I wish I could put this album out tomorrow. And in the popular music world, there's obviously so many more things to set up. But I wish that people could hear this album today.
How about the singles? How soon? A couple weeks?
You know what? We're internally discussing when to release the audio for the first couple of songs, right? And I'm hoping to do it very soon. And I might at some point just say, fuck it, let's go. Because I want people to hear what I'm hearing. You know what I mean? And doesn't mean it's going to be everybody's cup of tea. As a matter of fact, I'm sure it's not going to be everybody's cup of tea. And that is okay with me. I think it's going to be the masses' cup of tea, right? Mm-hmm. They call it pop music for a fucking reason, because it's the most popular. So my belief is that this is going to be extraordinarily popular. And so many people have told me that I'm dead on with that. Big names in the business. That I'm dead on.
Won't name drop.
I won't name. I can't name drop. But these people think that we have some really incredible things ahead of us. And all I want to do is start getting it out there and building it. You know what I mean? So it'll happen sooner than later.
Exciting new chapter for Strange Music. All right. Yeah. Again, December 9th, The Storm is in stores, and that's streaming all over line on Spotify
everywhere.
And everywhere,
yeah,
right?
Man, The Storm is going to come out 12/9. It's going to be absolutely everywhere. It's going to be in streaming. I mean, I still love the fans that take the time to go out and have the physical CD, artwork, music experience. For those who don't consume music that way, please listen to it as much as humanly possible. Put that shit on repeat on Spotify or Apple Music or whatever. Listen to it nonstop for me, please. Mm-hmm. And thank you. And you know, we're just going to go out there and try to spread great music. And when you hear some of the stuff on this album, you know, some guy said to me the other day, like, dude, it was yesterday. One of my friends said, man, you guys are like, released the whole damn album and before it came out. I'm like, bro, you've only heard five songs. There's so much music on here. But more importantly, the new dynamic of the business means that we can give the fans more music in advance. You know, and I see some of the old school guys on there. Dude, I just want to save the experience and listen to it all at once. I'm not going to listen to this song. You did too.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, you listened to it. But at the end of the day, the people who think, oh my God, he's released five songs already. This is going to take away from the experience. Did I tell you how many songs on the album? What is it?
Say it again.
19. 19 songs on the album, I'm not fucking up anything for you, right?
I'm excited for everybody to hear the full album, because I mean there are a lot of tracks on there. I have some personal favorites, and you know, one of the ones, because of the, I loved the song, but the video was great, What If It Was Me,
right?
And the duality of that, and what are we at, 2-3 million views on that or something like that?
I think a lot of people needed that message at that time, right? Because I think it tells both sides of the story. I think that when you put together visuals, and the video department, hats off to them. They did a great job. They fucking nailed that one. They nailed there's a lot of videos that I truly love that we put together. That being one of them, because it tells a story, and it doesn't do it from a one-sided way. Like, I'm very mindful and very conscious of not trying to let my artists get super political about things and take certain stances, because I think that it's a very subjective thing. I mean, if you look at the most current election, the country's divided from that standpoint. So, you know, I don't think that it's our place to try to influence that particular portion of politics. But the thing that I love about this is, whether you're on the Black Lives Matter side, which is a very important movement, or whether you're on the side of the officers who are out there and kind of being targeted right now, and man, when you see that, like, you see on this side, you see people, a dude being shot 5 times while running away. That's so ridiculous. And this over here, you see a dude being ambushed in a police car. Neither one of those things are okay with us, right? So what we try to do is we try to tell both sides of the story. And if you look at that video and you see the impact of the possibility of somebody being shot for trying to sell CDs, you know, and the backpack and the cargo pant and the mistake that was made there, that's a very real mistake that's happened to people in real life. And then you also look at the officer, or in this case, Chris, laying on the ground, dying, you know. I mean, dude, all these people are important. And so to tell a story that kind of shows both sides of it, I think is important. And I think people appreciate it. And, you know, I think that people appreciate it from both sides. And I think that hopefully that creates some kind of unity, realizing that we all may have a wife and kids to go home to. You understand what I'm saying? Black, white, fucking Latino, Indian, Asian, I don't give a fuck. That we're all people, and we're all very important, and we have to be respectful of life. And so hopefully that video, I think it connected, man, because like you said, millions of plays, and we put it out soft. We just said, we felt like it was an important message, and to put that out there and to get the kind of response that it's already gotten, super impactful.
Storm comes out December 9th, Strange Music CEO, Travis O'Gwen. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Strange Music.